Okay, please. Waiting for the students to come in.
Yeah, I think give it a minute.
Yeah, yeah, let them all come in. What's that, ma'am? Chatted. Okay, oh. Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. He's joined. And Jada. Okay. Good evening, everybody. Am I audible to all of you? If I am, please give a thumbs up. Thanks for the wave. Yes, good to see all of you here. Yeah, come. Yeah, wow, good. Yes, I can see Govind. Huh? Govind, okay. Divya, yes. Hello, hello. Hello, good evening. Very happy to see all of you. Really. How is the virtual lawyer doing? Are you happy with it? We've been trying to get very good people to deliver talks, senior advocates, academicians, wherever we could get judges, we've got judges, and we've got young advocates also, young academicians as well. I hope you are making good use of all of them. It is a little tiring at times, you know, getting people, coordinating, but my daughter's a big help. Yes. Yeah, and the initiative was actually taken by her. So I'm just giving a support. So how's everything treating you? In this COVID-19 pandemic? Bored with the lectures or still enjoying them? We want some responses. Because if you're bored, then maybe we'll take a break. Achha, internship as well. Oh my God. Okay, you want me to do that? Okay. Where do you actually want to intern online? I'll give you some links if you want to do internship online. Okay? Yes. When we had started these webinar series, I had delivered a talk on domestic violence. Okay? But it was a very hurriedly given talk because just a day before, my daughter had come to me and said, Mama, we are starting from tomorrow. So I said, okay. She said, please give a talk. So I said, all right. So in a day's time, however I could manage, I managed. It's been a long time now. I think it was sometime in the end of March that we had started. We had begun this platform and it's grown. And I'm so happy to see so many followers, so many of you interested, young people around me. Makes me feel very, very young all the time. I feel I'm back at the university. Yes. Can I start the lecture now? No? Okay. So today we've met here and I'm going to speak to you on violence against women, especially violence committed within the family. As you all know, it's been years and years and years since women have been troubled by violence, they've been oppressed, they've been suppressed. The society has always considered the women community as a marginalized community. Okay? We've never been in the mainstream. Whether you go back to the Vedic period or the post-Vedic period or the medieval period, the British period or the movement just before independence and finally the post-independent period. We see different stages of you know, the subordination and the oppression that women have suffered. If you look at the scriptures, whether you look at the Hindu scriptures, whether you look at the Muslim scriptures, whether you look at Christian scriptures, any religious scripture if you pick up, the status of women has generally been subordinate and low. Okay, so it's like I often say in my lectures that when somebody is making rules for you, somebody is chalking out legislation for you, that person will first protect himself and not the person for whom the rules are being made. So this is what applied to all of us. Okay, but nonetheless, in the times that we are going through today, things have changed, but we still have to go miles before we sleep. Okay, we still find violence has to be curtailed. So unless violence is curtailed outside the house or within the house, women cannot develop in a free atmosphere, and your country, your nation will not develop, because women constitute half of the population, not only within India but even across the globe. And violence against women is not new to India. It's been there since time immemorial and across the globe also. Now if I go back into history a little bit about who was the head of the family, like, you know that if you see the Hindu law, if you read the Hindu law, the Karta was the head of the family, isn't it? So the Karta was always the man who used to dominate, and he had the entire joint family under him. So much so that even the servants had to listen to him for everything. So he had full control over the house, you know, full empowerment. Gradually, students, as times changed, as legislations came into existence, as activists started speaking, as voices were raised, as reformers came into the scene, we find that changes did take place. But this patriarchal mindset which was there and which originated from the concept of Karta continued for a long time and got transferred into unequal power relations between men and women. Okay, so now when we look at patriarchy, it is actually the unequal power relations between men and women which is embedded in the society and which, you know, gives problem to each one of us in some way or the other. Whether it's a girl child, whether you're grown up as an adult, you are studying in colleges, going for higher education, whether you're a young married woman or whether you're a woman who's got a good job, everywhere we are facing challenges. But doesn't matter, we will face challenges and overcome them. Okay, so now when I look at violence against married women or women, other women within the family, before I go to the Domestic Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005, a little bit about, you know, after independence, when we had the Constitution of India, men and women have got equal rights under Part 3 of the Constitution, which contains the fundamental rights. Okay, but to date, we haven't got substantive equality. Okay, we've got equality to some extent, but it's not substantive equality. That is lacking in the society and lacking in our very being. So when we talk about Article 14, we talk about Article 15, we talk about Article 15.3, which empowers the state to bring out special legislations for women and children. When we talk about Article 16, which talks about jobs in public employment. When we talk about Article 21, right to life and right to liberty. Article 19, okay? Under all these articles, the Supreme Court of India has read many intangible rights for women which have become fundamental today. Okay, we can call them fundamental rights. So, like right to shelter, right to live with dignity, right to develop, right to not to be humiliated, okay, right to keep silent. All these are rights which have been read by the Supreme Court in various judgments. Now, when I come back to violence against women within the family, after we got independence, for some time, reforms as such were not made in our country. Yes, we did have legislations which made reforms into the Hindu law. Okay, we had the Hindu Marriage Act, and we had the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, Hindu Succession Act. But in Muslim law, the government refrained from interfering into the matter. It adopted the British policy of non-interference for some time because of the sensitive matter of partition. Okay, it did not want to touch that part at all. It was only gradually that it started bringing in changes. Now, we saw in the post-independent period that many women who got married were being subjected to a lot of torture, okay, either for dowry demand, that we had a lot of dowry deaths also, wife burning, bride burning. The Supreme Court took note of all these unfortunate incidents that were happening. And as, consumerism grew in our country, greed grew in our country, the demand for dowry kept on increasing. And forms of cruelty took different shapes against married women. So looking at the scene, at the scenario, the legislature came up with a section 498A in the year 1983, which was incorporated into the Indian Penal Code. Okay, of course, there were other sections also which were added after the Mathura case, gang rape case, policeman raping that woman. There were other rape laws that were changed after that also. But here, section 498A gave married women, some kind of a weapon or tool which they could use and get relief where cruelty was committed against them by their husbands or husband's relatives. Now, this particular section gave relief to the woman. It was for dowry-related demands and also where cruelty was committed and there was no dowry demand included. So, mental cruelty and physical cruelty were both covered under section 498A. Now, as things progressed, okay, and women made use of section 498A, and the lawyers were also very responsible, some of you may be lawyers also, for also when a matrimonial dispute comes before a lawyer, at that time, before this particular act came into being, the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, used to use section 498A to get relief to the woman, regarding money for the children, for herself, etc. There was no other way because the woman had no other way. She was thrown out of the house whenever there was a dispute and she had to go back to her parents' house and her parents were not ready to accept their daughter. That is how our society was. And it still continues to be so in many situations, unfortunately. Now then, it was seen that the moment a woman went under section 498A, she was not accepted back into the matrimonial home by the husband or the in-laws because they felt that the husband and the in-laws were brought out, in the public and there was a lot of public mudslinging and how could they take the daughter-in-law back? So the marriage invariably broke. So it was not helping women. So many women who were in unhappy relationships or were being subjected to physical cruelty, mental cruelty, continued remaining in their matrimonial homes till 50, 60 years of age also without saying a word because they felt very insecure leaving the home because they knew that the parents would not accept them and they didn't have jobs, they were not independent, most of them, and so they had to accept whatever they like. They thought it was destiny. In our country, everybody thinks that it's destiny and you have to accept it. But then destiny you can change also with hard work, with a different direction. You can also make things work. So many activists in our country, women rights activists, NGOs, academicians, saw that these things were happening. And there was a movement in our country that demanded a specific law for married women and other women who were within the family to protect them from violence and at the same time keep them safe at home. Now, Lawyers Collective worked on this, on the bill, for a long, long time. NCW also did it. And India had ratified, meanwhile, the Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Violence Against Women. Okay, had ratified that particular international convention. And it also recommended in its recommendations that all state parties to this convention must have legislations, must make efforts in their own states to curtail violence within the home. Till this act was framed, before that, the government policy was such that it did not want to disturb or interfere within the private domain. Okay, so in the public domain, the women were still being looked after. we had sections under the Indian Penal Code which dealt with criminal intimidation, molesting, rape, okay, cheating, grievous hurt. We had all these, but there was no specific legislation to deal with women who are being subjected to violence within their homes. And that is why it is rightly said, you know, that a woman might be raped outside by a stranger, but there is rape also within the home. And within the home can be by a known person or by the woman's own husband, okay, which we call marital rape. So after about, I can say 10 to 12 years, and after a lot of goading, we got this legislation, which came into force on 26 October 2006, which is called Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. Now, what is the objective of this act? This act is secular in nature. It is applicable to all women, married women or unmarried, mothers, widows, children below the age of 18 years, adopted, stepchildren or foster children. It's applicable to all. Okay. Now, to give effect to the policy underlying Article 14, Article 15, Article 21, this particular legislation came into existence. Now, what is domestic violence? Before I come to that aspect, I just like to tell you that this particular piece of legislation is divided into 5 chapters and it has got 37 sections. And when this particular legislation came into force, we also had the domestic violence rules in place, because unless you make the rules, you can't implement the act in totality. So the definitions are given in section 2 of the act, and you know, I'll take the major definitions. Who is an aggrieved party under, or aggrieved person under the act? It's a woman who has or is living in a shared household or domestic relationship with the respondent. Okay, then who is a respondent? Respondent would be an abuser, a perpetrator of violence committed against the woman who has alleged that violence is committed against her. Then what is domestic relationship? Domestic relationship means where there is a relationship between two persons who have lived together or had lived together or are living together in a shared household. Okay, it is either through consanguinity, through a live-in relationship, through adoption, through marriage, or it's family members, includes family members in a joint family setup. What is a shared household? Okay, shared household would be, okay, that the woman has lived with the respondent either singly or with him in a joint family or in a nuclear family or in a house owned or rented by both of them, or rented or owned by one of them or either of them, okay, as a married couple. Okay, and or I'll just come to the other aspect also. This particular legislation covers live-in relationships also. Okay, now live-in relationships have to be in the nature of marriage. Okay, and if you look at D. Velaswamy's case, in which Justice Kaju had written the judgment, he said a live-in relation should be a marriage which can be defined as a common law marriage, where the couple projects itself to the society as husband and wife. Okay, and you live in a shared household in a domestic relationship. Only that would be covered under or come under the purview of the act. And also the conditions should be satisfied for a valid marriage, like the age should be what the act says, and you know, the man should not have another spouse living, things like that. Either of them should not have a spouse living, and then they should qualify, they should have all the qualities by which a couple can get married. Okay, apart from the other conditions that I've told you. Now, what is domestic violence under the Act? Domestic violence is very widely worded under the Act. It includes physical abuse, sexual abuse, verbal abuse, emotional abuse, and economic abuse. So verbal and emotional abuse would also come under mental abuse. Okay, physical abuse has been defined as punching, kicking, throwing objects at the woman. Okay, also hitting, criminal intimidation, criminal force, wrongful confinement. Okay, forcing her to remain somewhere. And apart from that, verbal and emotional abuse would cover, like, hitting at the woman with taunts. Okay, you're dark, you're ugly, you're fat, you don't know how to cook, you have no confidence, you can't conduct yourself properly, you don't know how to talk to people when you go out, you don't know how to address people, you're not taking care of my parents, you're neglecting my parents, or you're neglecting your children, or you can't have a son, you are unworthy of having a son, or the woman cannot conceive, you are a barren woman, you know, all kind of hurts, all kind of taunts that are actually going to hurt her, that would come under verbal and emotional abuse. Also, that if, you know, for example, he can also say, if you do not give me money, or if you do not do this for me, I'll commit suicide. Okay, this is also emotional abuse. Or if you don't concede to this, I'll hit your children, I'll harm your children. Okay, anything which would pressurize a woman into agreeing to something, or in which she does it because she fears violence committed to herself or even her children. Okay, there's a long list, and there are some judgments where the courts have defined what physical abuse, what economic abuse, what verbal abuse means. Okay, now we come to sexual abuse. Sexual abuse, students, it can cover marital rape. Okay, now marital rape is not an offense in our country. To a limited extent, it is there under the Indian Penal Code. Very limited extent, where in a decree for judicial separation, if the man goes to the woman and has a relationship, physical relationship with her, that would constitute marital rape. Or then again, if it is below the age of 18, it is statutory rape or things like that. Okay. Now, under this particular legislation, we are all aware that marital rape is committed in every country. About 34 to 35 countries across the world have got legislation governing marital rape. But in our country, we do not have that legislation yet, because the people in power, the government, or the policies of the government, or the government itself is not ready for it yet, because they feel that women might misuse it. Okay, but it is a reality. So if a woman goes under the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act under sexual abuse, marital rape would be covered under this. And that could be a means for her to get a protection order. I'll just come to what a protection order means. Okay. But per se, it's not an offense. Under this act, it is not an offense. Okay. But then there are other forms of humiliating acts which could be of a sexual nature, which are violent or committed in a violent manner against the woman. So that is also protected. That kind of violence is protected under this particular legislation. Now we come to economic abuse. Economic abuse has been widely described, but again, it's not exhaustive. There are many forms of economic abuse that a woman can be subjected to. Apart from, you know, taking away her earnings if she's earning, not giving her much money, she can be denied money by her husband or in-laws to live in a particular manner that she's used to. Even her daily needs, for example, for her children, for clothes, for going out, for her small expenditure also. Anything that is denied to her, which is her right, you know, right of istri dhan, a right of enjoying property to a certain extent, or a right to maybe movable property which has been taken away from her, all this would come under economic abuse. So much so that her bank account, if it's a joint bank account and the money is withdrawn, you know, taken away, or the husband, you know, removes all his money and doesn't give to the woman, that also amounts to economic abuse. And it is the duty of the man to provide the woman with all the basic necessities in case there is, you know, violence committed and she wants relief. Those resources to which she was used to a particular standard of living, okay, that she was used to, that has to be given to her under this particular piece of legislation. Now, what happens when violence is committed against a woman? Let us see what the Act tells us. Now, under Section 12, an aggrieved party or an aggrieved person can go and file an application before the magistrate that, look, I have been subjected to violence by my husband or my relatives. Now, under the Act, there are different agencies. We have the police, we have the protection officer, we have the medical facility, and we have the service provider. The police is a very important agency for coordinating. Then the service provider would be NGOs, which have to be registered with the government, whether it's a central government or state government, to notify, which should be notified that they are available to women who are subjected to domestic violence under the Act. So all these agencies have to coordinate, work together to give relief to the woman who is subjected to domestic violence. Now, when an application is made under this particular legislation, it can either be by the person who is the aggrieved party, or if she is not in a position to lodge a complaint or make a complaint, then anybody on her behalf can go and lodge a complaint. It may be a police personnel, it may be a service provider, it may be a friend, it may be a relative, it could be a son, it could be a daughter, it could be a father, it could be a mother, it could be anybody. Okay? And the magistrate would take note of that particular complaint, would assess whether domestic violence has actually taken place, and also want a domestic violence incident report to be given to him. So here the role of a protection officer comes in, and protection officers are actually appointed by the government concerned through notification. Usually all these protection officers are women, and they must have experience in social work, for about must have, you know, some training also, education also, and experience of about 3 years. And the salary and the tenure is all prescribed by the government. Now, the protection officer is the backbone of the legislation, this particular legislation. She has to make the domestic violence incident report and give it to the magistrate. Now, the magistrate will look at the report, and if the complaint is considered to be valid, he would issue an order. If the order is asked for by the aggrieved party, a protection officer, through the protection officer, or if the woman wants it herself, and issue that. Now, the protection officer can be conditional or unconditional also. Okay, it can be conditional with subject to other conditions. Supposing a woman wants more than one order under this particular legislation. Now, the different orders that can be passed under the legislation, I'll just tell you. One is protection order. One is residence order. One is monetary relief order. Third is compensation order. Fourth is custody order. So the magistrate has the power to issue more than one orders. Now, if the woman who is being subjected to violence has children and she wants to keep the custody of the children, she would also request for a custody order. And temporarily, the custody would be given to the mother, to the woman who is being subjected to violence. Now, this does not mean permanent custody, but till the time the conditions are resolved or the matter is resolved. Now, for monetary relief, you know, if because of violence she has suffered medical, you know, like medical problems, okay, or she suffered her loss of earnings, or, you know, there are other things that she suffered in limb and she has to go to the hospital, etc. So she can be given money for this also by the husband or the relatives. Then we come to the compensation bit. Compensation is more like, you know, we have compensation under law of torts, okay, for the damages committed against her, okay, for the distress that violence has caused to her, for the pain, anguish that the violence has caused to her. And this compensation order will not be causing any prejudice to her right to seek compensation under any other law in place. It is in addition. Okay? So these are the different orders which are placed. And now, with respect to residence order, what happens is that when the husband is violent towards the woman, it is very natural that the warring partners should be separated. Because if you come in each other's way, obviously, you know, the pent-up feelings will emerge again. And the suffering that is there in a woman, or a man wants to be aggressive, he wants to continue his violence. So the cause for committing violence again and again is more in such situations. So the best thing is, the magistrate feels that if it is a big house, they will say, okay, a portion of the house should be given to the woman who is being subjected to violence, and the man should not go over there, and she should be allowed to cook or whatever until the matter is resolved. Now let us take a situation where the house is small. Now maybe it has only one room, then it becomes very, very difficult. In such a situation, the magistrate would say, okay, you take and tell the husband, you take another house on rent, another place on rent, and make the woman stay there, or you take a house on rent and you stay there. But then where in cases the courts have also said, you know, also told the man to leave the house, they've also cautioned that it should not be widely practiced, because after all, you cannot humiliate the man also. The law may be gender specific, this particular law, but then you also have to see the other side at the same time. So these problems come when the units are small. Okay. Now, besides these, after that, what happens is the protection, in case the protection order, which says that violence cannot be committed by the husband or the in-laws, is violated by the husband, what is the remedy? Now, the Act says that the husband can be put to jail for up to one year imprisonment, or fine, or both. And fine is around 20,000. But here I would like to mention to all of you that the idea behind this legislation is to give civil law remedy, not criminal law remedy. Because when criminal law remedy was given under Section 498A, it never worked. Okay, and marriages were broken. And this is not what women actually want. So here also, it is only that when a protection order is broken that the man would be, you know, asked to, you know, okay, he may be imprisoned or he may be fined, etc. Same goes for the protection officer. Now, the protection officer has a duty to work under this particular legislation together with the magistrate. And if he does not implement the order which is issued by the magistrate, he will also be subject to imprisonment, which can be extended up to 1 year, or fine of 20,000, or both. Okay? So now what happens is that suppose a woman is subject to violence in such a manner that she is physically impaired. Now here, if she needs medical facility, it is the duty of the protection officer to go to the medical facility with the woman and see that she is medically given the aid that is required. And if he doesn't do that, he is again not performing his duty. Now under the particular legislation, even the medical facility, the doctors have a duty to attend to the woman immediately. And the copies have to be written, you know, the report has to be written and given to the magistrate and to the police station where the cause of action or the woman resides, or temporarily or permanently, or the husband resides permanently, or the cause of action had arisen in a particular situation, right? So that there is again coordination between all agencies. Okay, so the police also has continuously to assist the magistrate, and the police has to be given all information about the violence that is happening in a particular place, and the police has to be told that the protection order or other orders which are issued by the magistrate must be implemented, and the enforcement bit has to be taken care of by the police, and it is the duty of the police to come forward. So here again we see that the coordination bit is there, and it cannot be done in isolation. Now, now I just want to. This is the gist of the Act, students. And what I would like to share with you is that the rules for implementation of this particular legislation were framed, and the rules given detail, you know, the actions that would be taken by different agencies. All right, and wherever the protection officer is performing his or her duty, it has to be in good faith, and they are not persecuted, neither is the service provider. Now that's an important provision under the legislation. It talks about counseling. the magistrate if he feels that counseling should be done of the woman alone, he will issue an order that counseling should be done. Now, or counseling should be done of the man, he will issue an order accordingly. Now, what happens, students, that it has been seen that when a woman is counseled alone, you know, pressure is put on her to go back to the family and accept violence, you know, in a way, and say that, okay, forgive and forget. Okay, that is what has been happening over the years for centuries, right? So the legislation also creates room for joint counseling, combined counseling. And I would always personally, you know, suggest, and I want to tell everybody who deals with women, you know, at this level, that it is wise for a magistrate to order combined counseling. Because when a man is counseled alone, it has been seen that he denies many of the acts that he's committed, unfortunately. So when the woman is there, the man is there, then he can be confronted and then he can't get away. So the matter can be resolved in a better manner, because the idea is not to break a marriage, to preserve a marriage. That is why this legislation was framed. It is not to break the institution of marriage. Okay, so that is why the sensitivity has to come in. So the magistrate role becomes very important here. And when counseling is ordered, the magistrate has to take about 2 months. He gives 2 months time for counseling to take place and then will take an action. Because whenever he gets a report about a domestic violence incident having happened, he has to take action within 3 days. Okay. And in any case, within 60 days, he must, you know, pass an order, the matter should be over, which does not happen, unfortunately. So these things which have not been made use of should be made use of under the legislation. I feel that counseling in one aspect, which earlier when the bill was, you know, being mooted and questionnaires were being framed and sent to all institutions, there was only a provision for joint counseling, but this was dropped by the parliamentary committee and said, no, let it be individual, you know, counseling also. So I feel here it would have been better if there was mandatory joint counseling of the couple. That would have been much better. Now, in living relationships, if the woman's partner is violent towards her, she can get the benefit of the act. Okay, as I told you, all the ingredients of a valid marriage should be there, you know, nature of a marriage. And the protection is given not only to her, but even her relatives. And if the partner's relatives are cruel to her, she can also have a cause of action against them. And nobody can come to her house and disturb her. Now, at the time when the protection office order is issued, the magistrate can also say that all the property which is jointly owned by the woman and the husband will be sealed. Okay? And the husband cannot take away the money from joint accounts, even from his own account, without the leave of the magistrate. He cannot dispose of even the istridhan or other gifts which have been given to him during or after marriage. And also, you know, the protection order can say that the woman should not be subjected to violence either orally, through letters, through SMS, through WhatsApp, electronic media, or through phones, or if she's working, stopping her on the way and threatening her. Any threat of violence would also come under this legislation. Okay, or also her children, not even torturing the children. Now, even a child under this particular legislation can be a victim, the aggrieved person. Okay, so the children also cannot be subjected to violence or torture or any kind of interference in when they go to school or on the way. So the order can contain all these directions. Okay, so yeah.
Question answer?
Should we start? Hmm. Oh, COVID-19, I didn't say that. Hmm. A bit about, before I go to the questions now, telling you about domestic violence, increase in domestic violence cases in the COVID-19 pandemic, it has gone up tremendously. And, there was a very, very powerful judgment given by Justice Geeta Mittal and Justice Prasad in Jammu and Kashmir some time back. The judges took so much notice of you know, the domestic violence cases that were happening in the union territories of Jammu and Kashmir. And the directions that were passed were very, very effective. And what she said was that it is very surprising that during the lockdown period, how can we say that violence against women within the family stops? It has gone up because the perpetrator is inside the house. The women are at home. There was no way that the woman could go out during lockdown. Jobs were taken away. And when a man is at home, obviously there are more chances of frustration coming out and more chances of the woman being subjected to violence. Earlier, she could have gone to her parents, gone to her friends, gone to some other NGOs or to NCW or anywhere that she could have complained, gone to the police station, gone to the protection officer. All these things were stopped. So Justice Geeta Mittal gave a slew of measures and directions to the state government and also members of the legal services authority in that particular union territory that they should allocate funds and keep it separately for women who are suffering because of domestic violence and see that telephone calls, online services, chat services are available to them easily and they can do things discreetly without their husbands coming to know or their intimate partners coming to know. Now, she also said that, you know, like pharmacies, grocery shops could have telephone or, you know, online services where the victims of domestic violence can relate to the people or to the government or any body, organization that, okay, they are being subjected to domestic violence and the perpetrator would not know about it. Okay. Yes. You want me to stop?
No, please go on, ma'am. We are listening. It's very interesting.
So the COVID-19 pandemic has been really, really terrible for women who have been at home. Now, many states of India, especially the high courts, have issued orders to the state and notice to the state to come out with a report and tell them how they are dealing with domestic violence cases. Now, NCW has come up with a chat box and also together with come out with one provision for women to complain. Incidents that are committed against them. Now, when we talk about in the European countries, it's not only in India the domestic violence cases have gone up. Even in European countries, whether it was Spain, whether it was Wuhan, whether it was China, whether it was Wuhan.
Ma'am, I'm losing audio. I can't hear you.
So much so that the partners were telling their women partners if they had symptoms of COVID, please leave a house, and they were thrown out on streets. Things were so bad. So this has to be dealt with, and it is still continuing, and we hope things will improve in the coming weeks, because things like this, emergency matters, do not stop when we have things like, you know, pandemics or wars, because violence continues, whether it is during war times or other times or pandemic times. Now, if you have any questions, I'm ready to answer.
Ma'am, we have a lot of questions. I was noting them down. Very interesting things for you. Very different. But I'll go by them one by one. And you may laugh. One is by Rant Cheetah. She said, do you think unpaid domestic labor done by women is a form of oppression as well?
Unpaid domestic labor?
Yeah. Unpaid domestic labor done by women is a form of oppression as well.
Form of oppression, but it won't come under domestic violence as such, no? Domestic, you have to share. It has to be a shared household domestic relationship. You get my point? Yeah.
Get my point. Understand.
Yeah. It is a different form of violence, but yes, you can. That'll come under harassment.
Harassment, right? Thank you.
Yeah. Because you know, domestic, you have to be in a shared household. Domestic, because domestic servants are not coming under this unless you are living as a family member. Okay, as a family member.
Unpaid domestic labor. Unpaid domestic labor done by a woman. So if a wife is doing unpaid domestic labor at home,
okay. When a wife is doing household chores, you mean?
Yeah, correct. You know? And like if she's being treated that she will be do that work, you know, the man is not helping around the house, I think so that's Well, I think the vein of the question goes.
Yes, if she takes it, yes, it is in a way, if it is beyond her means and she's not doing it voluntarily and she's falling ill and physically it's not possible for her to, it's a kind of abuse, I agree. It's kind of violence towards her only, but she is silently accepting it. Isn't it? You must be talking about the film made by Nandita Das.
I have no idea.
I think I have answered the movie.
So in case, you know, you want to look more into it, you can watch the movie.
Yeah, in a house, if she's, you know, working overtime, even looking after the house and also her job. And the husband is sitting. Of course, it will come under form of violence. She gets tired. She's a human being. Then it'll be like, it's kind of, because it's going to be manifested, it's going to affect her health. So anything which is going to affect her health would come as a form of violence under the act. Anything which is going to impair her.
So violence is of many types. It's not just physical, you know, it's mental, it's psychological.
Yeah,
it's, you know, a lot of people have that thing that they scream so loudly, it has an effect on you. I've seen such situations, you know. You know, people are just able to scream so badly that a person just, you know, it's both physically breaking for them and psychologically.
Look, yeah, very true. At one point of time, even our courts, you know, wanted to see visible signs of violence. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Even today, when a woman comes under the Domestic Violence Act before court, before magistrate, he would want to see the visible signs. And if he doesn't see, he would not give a protection order. So the Supreme Court has said, you know, that you have to exercise caution and see. But actually, because the act is enabling legislation, it's a welfare legislation. So you have to see that the woman is not suffering, but it, because it may not be just physical, it can be mental, emotional, economic.
Correct.
Okay, like you said, a woman being subject to, you know, doing work from morning till night in a house obviously is going to impair her health.
It's going to have effect on her mind, her working, how she functions.
Yes.
Correct. It could lead to depression. And like we've spoken about this on this platform many times, mental health, how important it is. And, you know, how that is the main way of getting through to someone, that they don't even beat you up. They torture you so much mentally that you leave the house, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, we have a right of residence under this particular legislation now. Because earlier when divorce proceedings started, a woman was thrown out of a house and she had to go to a parent's house. Some parents were very progressive and educated and accepted their daughters. But there are many who think that ek bari shaadi hogi to aapki arthi jayegi from the girl's house. So with this mindset, what does a woman do? So now because she has a right of residence, now she has a right to stay in a house, she will not be on streets. Neither would she be on streets, nor her children. It's a statutory right she's got now, which is not there.
I agree, ma'am. So, in fact, I think Reena Banot has only said, what an answer. Thank you, ma'am. She says she's written that.
Okay.
Moving on to the next question. We have Nishu Life. Nishu Life is, what is remedy if the husband is not paying sum of maintenance from the date of order passed more than a year ago? More than a year since he's, you know, there was an order, he's supposed to pay maintenance. This is actually, the same. Kajal has also asked the same question. Nishu Life and Kajal have asked the exact same question. That there has been an order, but no one has stopped paying maintenance. What legal recourse or remedy is there?
Yeah, maintenance, if you stop now, under the legislation, you either get, make the employer pay the areas of the maintenance, either in installments, you know, or then it has to be deposited in the court. The magistrate has to do it. You either get from the employer directly.
Okay.
You know, the man must be working somewhere. So you get an order where the employer would directly pay to the woman.
Oh, and if he is self-employed?
He's unemployed.
You know, the man is self-employed. He has a business of his own and he's showing. You know, this happens a lot of times. They show that they're unemployed, but they have a business of their own.
Yes, I know. But then she has to again go, I think, to speak to the magistrate because he'll make that the money is deposited in the court. He has to for the children and for the wife. It has to be done.
He has to go back and file another complaint, file another case.
Yes.
Look for a proper legal remedy.
I know. She loved, yeah.
ma'am, of course, this was the question from Nishu Life and not in the grind. Now coming to written Chatterjee's question, will delay in lodging a complaint under the DV Act put prosecution on a back foot, especially during this lockdown?
Delay in filing complaint of
Yes,
domestic violence.
under the DV
No,
Act.
no, no,
Okay.
no. It won't. Because there have been cases where the courts have said that this is an enabling legislation. So the limitation period as such would not apply in domestic violence cases. And also, domestic violence is a continuing offense. It's a continuing offense. So the cause of action continues.
So,
Yeah, tell me.
but going by that is that if it is a continuing cause of action, but if a husband hits a wife once, it will always be a continuing cause of action.
No, also, no. Okay, yeah, it can, but then if she accepts and it's after 20 years, she can't get up and say, oh, he slapped me 20 years ago. It
Correct.
has to be reasonable. It has to be reasonable. Okay, but
Correct.
then there are other forms of violence that he may be subjecting her
I'm
to.
playing, right. So like
Okay,
financial, psychological,
other
mental,
ways,
all of those things.
psychological, yes. And then,
Yeah.
basically, the act protects the dignity of the woman. And domestic violence, how a woman perceives it, is very relative. It is very different. Okay? Because I remember when I did my PhD on crimes against women within the family, and I had read the report written by Sakshi, a survey done on domestic violence. Some judges, whatever, she had interviewed judges and lawyers. And one judge had said that even one slap against a woman or to a woman could amount to domestic violence, or a series or a number of slaps may not amount to domestic violence to a woman. Because initially, when a woman is subjected to violence, the parents usually say, "Koi baat nahi, theek ho jayega." Okay,
Correct, correct.
ye gusse mein kar diya hoga. Understand? But
Yes, ma'am.
this is what, it's a mindset in the society that has to change. That is why we need
That
to
is why these
sensitize.
legislations are so extreme and so harsh. That is why they are so woman-centric, because it's not about just changing, it's just not about punishing. It's about changing the entire, mentality of
Mindset,
society. Yes.
thinking,
See
yes,
that all this
yeah.
girl has to do is to file a complaint and you'll go to jail. It is for the woman that, yes, and even then what I did read, ma'am, was that a lot of those cases, go unreported in India. So many different types of crimes against women are completely underreported. They are never mentioned. They are, mostly immaryada. A very little population of the country stays in urban areas, even lesser of those believe in, getting the rights of the women out there. So this underreporting, which many times there is a fact that listen, there are more crime reported there. We say, or the point is,
at least they're reported. They're not
Yes, this,
reported here.
yeah. So why are they not being reported? Because the police doesn't write them down. Domestic violence in our country is not recognized as a crime.
I can't
So
hear you.
unless domestic violence in our country is not recognized as a crime, so unless it is
There's an audio problem.
recognized,
I'll just come back.
yes. Violence